my pleasure to welcome you to the Abraham Lincoln Library and Museum. We appreciate your being here for our 2017 Kincaid Lecture. This lecture has been made possible by the generosity of Hansel and Dorothy Kincaid, now deceased. In honor of Mr. Kincaid's late uncle, Dr. Robert L. Kincaid, who served as president of LMU from 1947 through 1958. In addition, their generosity has allowed the museum to create the Robert L. Kincaid Endowed Research Center and to design a new exhibit on Lincoln's pre-presidential life. The mission of the new research center is to promote the scholarly study and public understanding of the influence created by the Judeo-Christian ethic upon the heir and the legacy of Abraham Lincoln. This mission is being accomplished through special lectures, sponsored student research, exhibitions, and an enhanced collection focusing on the religious life in the early United States and on the influence that American politics and religion have had on each other. We are grateful to the Kincaids for their generous support. We welcome Dr. Paul Harvey as our speaker tonight, and he will be introduced by Dr. Thomas Mackey, Director of the Museum.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Let me do a few housekeeping details, make sure we're ready to go for our speaker. Dr. Harvey wanted to have some slides this time, so we'll have that one. In the meantime, we also have a student of mine. This summer, we had an intern, Dieter Irwin, who actually, Dieter, what is your major again? Dieter is not a history major, I'm sorry to say. We would like to have her as a history major. What is your major?
Conservation biology.
This lady, this young scholar, dove into a whole series of primary sources titled The Evangelical Family Library. 15 volumes of Protestant religious writing. That takes guts. And worked out an article, and this next week we'll be making a presentation on her findings. Just a little bit about what you've done with this, please.
So first off, I'd like to thank the museum and everybody associated with the Kincaid Research Center for this opportunity to advance my research and writing skills. But I got to, as Tom said, research the Evangelical Family Library set of books. It is a 15-volume set that we have here at the museum that is a primary source. I got to dive in and see all the different authors that are associated with these books and all the different writings. So what I did was kind of make an overview paper and some of the different topics that are associated with these books. And so on Tuesday, September 26th, I will be giving a talk in here at 1 p.m. So if you would like more information about what I did, please come to that. Thank you.
Thank you. One of the disadvantages, that's a slight with the museum, is that during the summer months, we have a lot of visitors, and but we often don't have many students. I really enjoy having our students. So this summer, we had a student with us, and she did a lion's share of work up here. And not even being a history major, but she is a very talented researcher and did a wonderful job in this project. And actually, I think made a good part of our team this whole summer. Further housekeeping details. We have reception for everybody out there. Please stay and talk. We're going to be having a question and answer session. All of you have got in your little bags, you have a notepad. Now, you can take notes in the notepad. You can also find out some questions. So you think of something puzzling. We had a lunch today, and a lot of questions are flying about at lunch with our speaker. We're looking at a very crisis-ridden society, so think of some things. Now, don't be nice to the gentleman, but think of some questions that really have the posers, something with this theme. Dr. Paul Harvey, our speaker today, is a history professor and presidential teaching scholar at the University of Colorado, got his PhD from the University of California in Berkeley. And he writes and teaches an American history from the 16th century to the present. So wide scan here. Some of his books that he's already published: Redeeming the South, Religious Cultures and Radical Identities; Freedom Coming, Religious Cultures and the Shaping of the South; Bounds of Habitation, Race and Religion in American History. This is out on the counter. These books, two of his books are available out there, and he'll be signing editions for you. He comes also as an award-winning teacher. He has a Faculty Award for Excellence in Research and an Outstanding Teaching Award from the University of Colorado. He's won his university's Chancellor's Award, and he's been a senior mentor to young scholars at the American Religious Program at Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis, or as they say, UE. I actually stopped saying that now. I guess that's a wonderful act. Why not? We had a wonderful time this morning with Dr. Harvey. A lot of the things he's changing a little differently here, so I ask you to welcome Dr. Paul Harvey. You hooked up?
Okay. Okay, let me see if you can hear me. You guys can hear me, everybody at the top? Okay, great. So first of all, Tom, thank you so much for everything that you've done and just for this entire day. I've had such a wonderful time here. So there's a couple things I'm going to remember. One is the Lincoln shot glasses out there. I really want them because I didn't want to get an Andrew Johnson shot glass to accompany that. I don't know where to get an Andrew Johnson shot glass. You know, if you get that, I'd really like to get that. And secondly, I'm going to remember the Holiday Inn in Middleborough, Kentucky, which has a series of prohibitions on their elevator sign, no smoking, the usual stuff. But one of their prohibitions is no loud singing in the shower. I've never seen that in any other place. So me, being who I am, what did I do this morning? I was singing like anything in the shower, just because I just have a thing about breaking rules like that. And I also want to thank the funders of this endowed lecture series. It's just really, it's been a wonderful place to be in today, and just the beautiful weather. And we were just at Cumberland Gap, the town down there with their little sandwich shop, and had a great time there. A couple of other things I wanted to say. Deidre, you need to be a history major. Can you do that for me, please? Thank you. Appreciate it. And then secondly, for those of you who were here this morning, so some of this talk is going to be the same, especially the first part of it. But this morning's talk was kind of like 200 years of American history, and tonight's talk is really going to be, because of the nature of the museum and the nature of this lecture series, is really going to be more 19th century Civil War era. So when I teach the Civil War era at the University of Colorado, I think of it as basically like the 1830s to the 1880s. I'm going back just a little bit further at the beginning of this talk. We'll sort of pick up about the 1810s, but really we're talking in most of the talk about the course of Abraham Lincoln's life, and then one generation beyond that life. And so the first couple people that I'm going to be talking about are, first couple people are going to be sort of at the beginning of what would have been Lincoln's life, and the last couple are going to be after Lincoln's life. But what I want to do is start with the famous address of Frederick Douglass in 1852, What to the Slave as a 4th of July. Apologies for those of you this morning who've heard this before, but I'm going to talk about it again. So he asked, what to the slave is the 4th of July in 1852? And I notice every year now on my Facebook feed, my academic friends repost this speech, and my non-academic friends post fireworks and hyper-nationalist things about how wonderful America is. And it gives me a little sense of kind of some of the divisions of the country. But Frederick Douglass famously says, what to the American slave is the 4th of July? Keep in mind, this is 1852, after the Compromise of 1850. I answer, a day that reveals to him the gross injustice and cruelty to which he is the constant victim. To him, your celebration is a sham, your boasted liberty and unholy license. Your national greatness, swelling vanity. Your sounds of rejoicing are empty and heartless. Your denunciations of tyrants, brass-fronted impudence. Your shouts of liberty and equality, hollow mockery. Your prayers and hymns, your sermons and thanksgivings, with all your religious parade and solemnity, are to him mere bombast, fraud, deception, impiety, and hypocrisy, a thin veil to cover up crimes which would disgrace a nation of savages. There is not a nation on the earth guilty of practices more shocking and bloody than are the people of the United States at this very hour. So in preparing for this talk, I was looking up this address again and forgetting that before this very famous passage comes, there's a lengthy hymn of praise for the American Revolution. Often forgotten is the entire first half, really the entire first two-thirds, I would say, which is an extended meditation on the history of the American Revolution, the heroic deeds of the founders, their commitment to liberty, their brave revolt against the leading a bedraggled collection of people in diverse colonies against the mighty military force of the British. So he's defending the revolution and he's saying, in effect, I understand for white Americans what this means because it fulfills the promises of that. And then halfway through, pivots to this excoriation of slavery and most especially of the slave trade. And by the slave trade, he's talking about the internal slave trade, massively selling slaves from the Upper South to the Lower South, which eventually involved about 1 million people sold approximately through the first half of the 19th century. So, and when he does this, he hits the churches hard. At the very moment that they are thanking God for the enjoyment of civil and religious liberty and for the right to worship God according to the dictates of their own conscience, they are utterly silent in respect to a law which robs religion of its chief significance and makes it utterly worthless to a world lying in wickedness. And then he continues, the church of this country is not only indifferent to the wrongs of the slave, it actually takes sides with the oppressors. It has made itself the bulwark of American slavery and the shield of American slave hunters. He is, of course, talking about the Southern church, but he's also talking about Northern. He says the American church. He doesn't say the Southern church, he says the American church. So he's sort of condemning American Christianity as a whole. Many of its most eloquent divines who stand as the very lights of the church have shamelessly given sanction, the sanction of religion and the Bible to the whole slave system. For my part, I would say welcome infidelity, welcome atheism, welcome anything in preference to the gospel as preached by those divines. And so his 4th of July address is encapsulating both in its praise of the revolution and in its excoriation of slavery and the slave trade, the political and religious philosophy of many 19th century African Americans, including both the cosmological hope placed in and the bitter critique placed on the American experiment. And that's what I'm going to talk about tonight by using several examples from the 19th century to talk about how Americans, African Americans in particular, in their political thought, deployed religion in various ways to try to grapple with the immense problem of living in a white supremacist slavery republic. The theme of this series is the Judeo-Christian tradition. So let me say, first of all, that for this talk, I'm not going to use that term because it's anachronistic. There's no such term in the 19th century, and especially before the World War II era. So as often happens in historical writing, I'm going to be talking about something where my subjects would actually have no idea what we would be talking about if we use that term. I'm not even sure they would recognize the term Christian tradition. That's also a bit of a later term. So what they would have said is the Christian religion. That's the term that they use. So that's the term that I'm going to adopt tonight. And they use the term the Christian religion singularized like that, the Christian religion, by which basically they meant the Protestant religion for the most part. So I might use that term tonight as it's the most appropriate for the part of the 19th century, the 1810s to the 1880s, with a particular emphasis on the Civil War era that I'm going to be talking about tonight. So my main thing is the fact that the Christian religion is both savior and tormentor to African Americans. Excuse some self-promotion there on my book on the left-hand side there, that's outside for you, Through the Storm, Through the Night, which has a similar kind of theme that it explores for the entirety of African American history. African Americans had a tortured relationship with the Christian religion as their savior and as their tormentor. They appealed to the true principles of Christianity as opposed to the false preachings of pro-slavery advocates. But in fact, it was their tormentor, and there was no way around that, and they knew that. Further, the entire cosmology of 19th century Christianity was racialized. blacks knew the Son of Ham story as well as whites, and because they did, they had to figure out ways to deal with conceptions of Christianity that from their most basic assumptions were racialized. At the same time, Christianity provided a venue, both necessary and sufficient, as some saw it, to critique American slavery, racism, and the political structures that underlay both. And so hence the paradox of African-American politics and the tradition that we now call Judeo-Christian, the same paradox which Frederick Douglass so brilliantly explored in his 4th of July address in 1852. So I'm going to explore this theme by looking at how a select group of African-Americans deployed, wrestled with, argued with, and transformed the Christian tradition, the Christian religion. And my subjects are going to include everyone from slaves in the Deep South to highly educated free black Northerners and missionaries. And my subjects are chosen to include representatives of fierce internal debates among African Americans about what was the best way for them to consider the relationship between the Christian religion and the political issues of the mid-19th century. What did the Christian religion have to say about slavery and the Constitution, for example? That was a subject of very fierce debate. Other examples: could the Prince of Peace support a violent war against slavery? And could a principled anti-slavery Christian support a constitution whose very structure, some argued, helped to preserve a pro-slavery republic? And I'd like to do that by looking at the evolution of African-American political thought from the 1810s to the 1890s, its relationship to and effect on the Civil War and its transformation during the first generation of freedom, so very broadly, as I said, through the Civil War era. The focus here is both on the eschatological hopes and bitter disappointments, on a conflicted but necessary and inevitable relationship with Christian thought in a white man's republic, a white man's Christian republic, and on internal debates in the African American community on whether this Christian republic would ever have a place for men who were not white. And so this debate, the debate that they were carrying on through the course of the 19th century, goes deep into questions about what we can expect of religion as a society. Is it a set of institutions and practices, churches and ministers and hymns and that kind of thing, or is it an idealized language by which we envision a better world to come? And what if that idealized language is precisely the language of racism, the language of the white man's Christian republic, the language that was so powerfully influential through the first half of the century. That is, if the language structures of the American, specifically American Christian tradition, as expressed in the United States, in the early United States, are embedded with the assumptions of racial hierarchy, then how do those of the Christian tradition who are not white deal with that? If America is culturally a white Christian republic, then where does that leave African American people? These are the kinds of really hard questions that they were trying to figure out. And this is an important question historically as well for our contemporary situation as we grapple with the well-known recent events and tragedies from Charleston to Charlottesville and in a more general sense to racially motivated violence, not only in the United States but all over the world. African Americans, in fact, had a long history of facing racialized terrorism directed against them, centuries of it, in fact. Sometimes, perhaps even often, deriving from religious motives. So the questions we confront are the same ones that they historically have confronted and struggled with as well. They had to ask, is white violence so basically embedded in the narrative of white Christianity that there is no escaping it? As you'll see, some people said, no, there are means to escape it. Other people had different views of that. And if Christianity was embedded in the very narrative of the nation, and many African Americans had adopted it, then was there a truer Christianity that superseded the racialized version fundamental to American history? Was there a non-racialized religion of Jesus that superseded the American religion of Christianity, in other words? So these are some of the questions that we're going to be talking about here, and we'll be looking at some contrasting answers and responses that the different figures gave to each. So So let me talk a little bit first, just a brief background about African-American Christianity in general. It developed, within the severe limitations of the slave regime, and it developed within the severe limitations of a segregated northern society. Segregation as a social practice was in fact invented in northern cities related to streetcars and things like that in the 1830s, 1840s, 1850s. And regardless of the rhetoric of Christian freedom and equality, there was an obvious power gulf between whites and blacks in bondage. Slaves could not simply make their own world. Slaveholders held the power. And yet the actions of the slaves constrained the power of slaveholders. In the 19th century, slave rebels employed biblical reasoning to instigate slave rebellions. Other slaves who could not or would not engage in overt acts of rebellion found ways to use the Christian message subversively. So the Great Awakenings, partly stemming from the 18th century, but then carrying on for the first half of the 19th century, were also the catalyst for the formation of the first independent black denominations, by which I mean especially the African Methodist Episcopal Church, organized informally in the 1790s, incorporated formally in 1816 in Philadelphia. The Black Philadelphians began, and I'm going to be talking about a couple of people here, Richard Allen and Daniel Coker, so I'm going to flip over to them. So two of the key founders of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. They began corresponding with black Methodists elsewhere and developed close relationships with fellow worshipers in Baltimore, where Daniel Coker, who you see up here on the left, a native of Maryland and escaped slave, led adherents to the Methodist faith. In 1810, Coker published a really significant early anti-slavery text called Dialogue Between a Virginian and an African Minister, which was a fictionalized conversation. This was the kind of genre of literature at the time in which people would sort of present a conversation that happened, but it was in fact a fictionalized conversation, but it was their way of sort of making the points that they wanted to make. And in this conversation, a good-hearted but misguided Virginia slaveholder comes to understand the fallacy of his own pro-slavery views through the reasoned discourse of and well-informed, biblically-based arguments of a black minister. So they have a chat, and the Virginia slaveholder at the end says, "Gosh, I'm wrong, aren't I?" And it's a very sort of gentle piece of anti-slavery literature. In 1817, 1 year after the formation of the AME Church, a group of elite Southern and Northern whites formed the American Colonization Society, the ACS, as I'll call it. Its purpose was to provide for the immigration of blacks to Africa. Their argument was slavery is wrong, but blacks don't have any place in the American Republic. If blacks would move back to Africa, then two problems get solved all at the same time, effectively was their argument. And thereby solving America's intractable problems of slavery and race. This philosophical dispute about the destiny of African Americans, whether there was a place for them in the American Republic, split AME churchmen of that era. Daniel Coker, ironically, was the one who began to argue for immigration to Africa, and in fact did it himself and lived the last 23 years or so of his life in West Africa. He and his followers believed that God would use the evil of slavery to prepare a group of Christianized African Americans to bring the gospel message to Africans who remain mired in heathen customs. Richard Allen, his fellow founder of the AME Church, and a majority of AME leaders, however, were appalled by groups like the American Colonization Society. They were appalled by the idea of colonization. Richard Allen, after all, lived in Philadelphia during the American Revolution and Constitutional era. He saw himself as American as they came. During the yellow fever epidemic of 1793-94 in Philadelphia, Richard Allen and his black churchmen went around and picked up dead bodies killed by the yellow fever, because that's the job black people did in Philadelphia. So he said, "Who can be more American than me?" And they also insisted on the full citizenship rights of black people as Americans. Richard Allen and his close friend, Absalom Jones, already had put this philosophy into practice. In 1797, Jones authored one of the first African Americans petitions to Congress on behalf of 4 runaway slaves who had been kidnapped by slaveholders and brought back to the South as slaves. And as we know, through the course of the antebellum era, this kind of incident happened time and time again. Jones, Allen, and the other early Black Methodists fused a number of different sentiments together, including Christian universalism, ideas of universal equality and citizenship rights, and Black separatism. After all, the African American Methodist Episcopal Church, there was a reason it was called Africa, because everyone knew who it was for. And this was a delicate balancing act between Christian universalism, universal equality, citizenship rights, and Black separatism. A delicate balancing act, one which thereafter defined the role of Black Christian churches. They claimed an African heritage and understood Black churches and societies to be necessary for the defense of African American rights, but they also insisted on their status as free Americans, subject to every protection under the laws. In short, they sought to be Africans, so why they put that title in the name of their church, and Americans, conscious of their heritage, but securely placed as American citizens, and very much opposed to the ideas of colonization that were a kind of a rage amongst a lot of white conservative Northerners at that particular time. The works of the Boston shopkeeper and African Methodist David Walker further accentuated white fears of the democratic religious ideas of freedom prevalent among Black Christians. In the few decades before David Walker's appeal to the colored citizens of the world, published in 1829, Black pamphleteers such as Daniel Coker tried to convince whites of the clear relationship between American Protestantism and American freedom. They were in effect looking for dialogue with white Protestants, saying, our Protestantism supersedes the things that divide us. Our Protestantism puts us together and our racial differences are inconsequential by comparison. That argument begins to fade through the antebellum era. During the 1810s and 1820s, the assumptions of a universalist Christianity put in the context of a free and democratic republic kept Black Christian writers imbued with visions of imminent freedom, including Coker. But then, as I said, Coker, ironically, is the one who ends up supporting colonization. And in subsequent decades, these kinds of polite dialogues, like Coker wrote in 1810, gave way to polemically powerful attacks on slavery and slaveholders, culminating in David Walker's appeal in 1829. So Walker was a free man of color, born in North Carolina, and he understood the biblical, and he was a tailor by trade. He ends up moving to Boston where he's a clothesmaker. And then he ends up dying there for reasons nobody actually knows why he died, probably tuberculosis, 1829, 1830. And Walker understood the biblical message to contain revolutionary anti-slavery sentiments, and he advocated violent revolt against the slave system. Are we men, I ask you? Oh, my brethren, are we men? God had not made any man to be slaves, but because all men were as dying worms, like John Calvin thought, in the eyes of the Creator. And whites, too, would have to appear before the Lord's judgment in the last days and account for their deeds. The only true master, after all, was Jesus Christ. In the end, all would submit to him. Christian messianism, that is, the idea that Christ would come and establish a righteous order on earth, deeply influenced David Walker. It's just infused with that 19th century style Christian messianism. His appeal showed whites that there was no telling how Black Americans might understand the message of the evangelical revival. Nonetheless, despite the biblical admonition that in Christ there was neither Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free, American evangelicalism through the antebellum era, in practice, as it was practiced, reinforced and policed racial boundaries in American society. The Great Awakening had a message of universal equality, and it had some success at attracting white and Black believers who worshiped together. And it could have produced an American style of evangelicalism which might have undermined the racial system of the country, in particular times and particular places, very local times and very local places. It, in fact, did that sometimes, but not very often. Ultimately, what it did was to define and undergird the racial hierarchy by declaring that this American social order developed through the antebellum era reflected the will of God, and that God expected men and women to perform their duties within the social stations given to them in that order. African Americans responded by shaping Christianity for their own purposes. both within recognized religious institutions like the Black Methodist churches, as well as in informal gatherings where an egalitarian version of evangelicalism reached the height of its expression. Black Christians challenged the racially egalitarian social order of American life in their own institutions, as well as in the backwood meetings and slave quarters. Slave preachers, and most especially slave music and religious ritual, kept alive a message of freedom in ways that sustained generations through the storm and through the night of the antebellum years, when cotton was king, representing some 50% approximately of the American economic output by dollars, and slavery's expansion seemed unstoppable. And so when I say slavery's expansion seemed unstoppable, think about the position of Black evangelicals through the 1820s, 30s, 40s, and if you think about slavery in 1790, which is confined to a very small areas along the eastern seaboard, and then over the next two generations, 1790 to 1860, in a way that nobody anticipated, was a complete shock to everyone in some ways, exploded and became the dominant economic force of American society and extends through the 13 states all the way down to Texas. Nobody knew that was gonna happen. Thomas Jefferson didn't know it was gonna happen. Nobody else knew it was going to happen. And the people living through that and those being sold had to grapple with the consequences of that. And slave preachers had to deal with the consequences of that. In services held in slave cabins or in the woods at night, African Americans developed a religious culture that brought together elements of their African past and their exposure to American evangelicalism. The rise of the Black spirituals as the primary form of African American religious music suggests a lot about the blending of the African past, particularly in the rhythms and in the sounds of the music, and the American present. The spirituals came from a mixture, a complex mixture of white evangelical hymnology, Black traditional song and dance, Black Southern folklore, and from lots of hymn books that were drifting from Northern publishers, some of them written or published by Richard Allen, and finding their ways into Southern communities and eventually to slave communities. Many spirituals have some base in the white popular evangelical tunes that were making their way to the churches in the newly settled era. But of course, the slaves also brought their own images and literary devices into the songs. These derived as much from their African heritage as from their white Christian training. And thus the spirituals emerged as the communal voice of slave believers. And so much debate about the spirituals has focused on the degree to which the lyrics contained encoded kinds of messages. This is something that we were talking about at lunch today, as a matter of fact. To what degree, we may ask, was the spiritual freedom referred to in many songs a code for freedom of slavery? And the answer is, it could be interpreted all kinds of different ways. These are lyrics that have different kinds of meanings to different people in different time contexts. The lyrics mean one thing in 1820, the lyrics mean another thing in 1860. That's my answer in brief to that question. Not surprisingly, enslaved Blacks drew on Old Testament stories and their spirituals exalted heroes such as Moses. They also turned New Testament figures such as Jesus into avenging heroes. Slaves, of course, as you all know, took up the story of the enslaved Israelites in Egypt as their own, despite the attempts of slave masters to prevent these passages in the Bible from being taught. This shows that many slaves had to be aware of the potential multiple meanings of what they sang. Meanwhile, Northern Black churches, especially those affiliated with the AME and the AMEZ Church, the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, sponsored publications which allowed African Americans to articulate, especially free African Americans, to articulate their religious strivings. First published in the 1850s, the Christian Recorder, you see a sampling of it there, served as the AME Church's official newspaper, and it served as the central repository of African American religious thought. It was not only a newspaper, but it was also a place where Black businessmen could put their ads. It was a place after the Civil War where hundreds and hundreds of people put ads looking for slave, their husband who had been separated from them, their son or daughter who had been separated from them from slavery. So these are some of the most moving ads, as you see, family members trying to relocate each other after slavery. One example of there is up on the screen for you. Later publications, including the AME Church Review, provided African-American ministers with a forum to discuss theological issues. And so, for example, they were discussing some of the great theological debates of that particular era. Okay, what do we make of this new thought coming from Germany that says that there was actually five different authors of the Old Testament, however many there were, I can't remember what the story of that is. But they're talking about the stuff that's all Quran for their day, as far as theological debates. They also hosted conventions in which black men and women expressed their political views, especially in regard to abolition and in defense of full black citizenship rights. In this sense, northern black churches already were centers of political activity, preparing the way for southern black churches to serve a similar role after the Civil War. And they sponsored men and women such as Maria W. Stewart. Through the antebellum years, black Christian pamphleteers pressed the cause for freedom. We've already talked about one, David Walker, and his appeal to the colored citizens of the world. Other black abolitionist speakers, including Maria Stewart, often employed religious rhetoric through the antebellum era. Maria Stewart defended African-American rights with what she called a holy indignation. She condemned whites who professed to be Christians while embracing race prejudice. Drawing on the Old Testament, Stewart compared Americans to King Solomon, who got credit for building a temple, even though he didn't do any labor on it. Likewise, white Americans claimed credit for black workers' achievements. She said, "We have pursued the shadow while they have obtained the substance. We have formed the labor, they have received the profits. We have planted the vines, they have eaten the fruits of them." White Americans, she said, were like the biblical Babylonians, thinking themselves exalted while they sold the souls of men into slavery. Other kinds of black publications, these black denominational newspapers, and newspapers such as Frederick Douglass's The North Star, published out of Rochester, New York, employed biblical passages to condemn slavery and featured lengthy reprinted debates between the black intellectuals of the era as far as what they were going to do about slavery. So following his fight for freedom in the 1830s, Frederick Douglass, of course, as you all know, served as a powerful propagandist for the anti-slavery cause. Residing in Rochester, New York in the 1850s, he published the North Star, where he attacked the slave system and the so-called revivalism that accompanied its spread. He told one abolitionist gathering, famously, "Revivals in religion and revivals in the slave trade go hand in hand together. The church and the slave prison stand next to each other. The groans and the cries of the heartbroken slave are often drowned in the pious devotions of his religious master. While the blood-stained gold goes to support the pulpit covers the infernal business with the garb of slavery." And he gave the example, slaveholders financed missions to the slaves. How did they finance missions to the slaves? By the profits of slaveholding. What could be more hypocritical than that, he asked. After preaching to slaveholders in the main, or I should say, Douglass mocked and parodied the hypocritical pieties of white Southern preachers. After preaching to slaveholders in the main part of the church, Douglass told riveted audiences with impeccable comic timing. He said, "The slaveholding preachers gaze up at the gallery and with comical hypocrisy urge the slaves to labor diligently. Then they exclaimed with false piety that God had given slaves strong bodies with which to labor, while he had given the white master class delicate physical constitutions, but wonderful minds by which they could do the thinking. This gospel," Douglass scoffed, "more than chains or whips or thumbscrews, gives perpetuity to this horrible system." Now, Douglass had a major intellectual opponent of that era, one who was far more skeptical than Douglass himself of the degree to which black Americans could expect a nonviolent end to slavery, and that was the Presbyterian minister Henry Highland Garnett, second only to Douglass in that era in renown and accomplishment. But Garnett, unlike Douglass, advocated physical resistance to oppressive conditions. By implication, he encouraged violence to overthrow white supremacist power. So we think of this kind of debate in the 20th century with sort of like Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, figures like that debating. And I think that Garnett and Douglass were having a very similar debate in this era, and I'm talking about the 1840s now. Garnett delivered his famous address to the slaves of the United States to a national convention of black clergymen, authors, and abolitionists in 1843. And it was not published because it was too inflammatory. And so the black convention that was meeting in 1843 in Buffalo, New York, basically said, we're not going to publish this because they're going to come kill us if we publish it. But it did, some years later, finally appear in print. Recounting the history of the forced migration of African Americans to the land of slavery, Garnett claimed that God had, quote, frowned upon the nefarious institution, and thunderbolts, red with vengeance, struggled to leap forth to blast the guilty wretches who maintained it. Slavery had overwhelmed America, supposedly a land of Christian piety, even as the church stood by silently. Slavery, not Jesus, he said, was now king, reigning over the United States, and would have to be resisted violently. He urged black Americans to use every means at their disposal, including violence, to make clear their hatred of the degrading system. Black Americans should take as their motto, resistance, capital letters, resistance, he said, for that was the only sure way to secure their liberty. And so Garnett's message was one which combined Christian piety as a Presbyterian minister with notions of violent resistance. A majority of black ministers and leaders attending that convention in 1843 opposed Garnett and basically squelched his speech from being published. Douglas and others, quite understandably, insisted that it would simply be suicidal for slaves to follow such a course. And in fact, it would probably be impossible for slaves to follow such a course. But black conventions, attended and often led by black ministers, continued the struggle against slavery. The 1847 National Convention of Colored People in Troy, New York, insisted, quote, there shall be no peace to the wicked, and that this guilty nation shall have no peace, and that we will do all we can to agitate. The convention recognized that both the press and the pulpit alike had been prostituted, that was the term they used, prostituted to serve slavery. So Frederick Douglass consistently articulated universalist ideals of black integration into the American Republic, resistance to all forms of separation and colonization, and a belief that the Constitution was actually an anti-slavery document. And interestingly, Douglass in this sense was opposed to his white colleague, William Lloyd Garrison, who did not think that the Constitution was was an anti-slavery document. Meanwhile, other black clergymen, such as Henry Highland Garnett that I've just talked about, and Martin Delaney, a black nationalist author in the 1840s and 50s, pressed the case for resistance and separate black institution. Delaney said that the determined aim of the whites was to crush the colored races wherever found. Only an active resistance could forestall this work of universal subjugation. So black Christians are espousing opposing philosophical positions on what the Bible required or allowed in the fight against injustice. And their divisions presaged debates in the coming century over how best to oppose oppression and racism in America. By and large, black religious organizations took the positions of those who, like Maria Stewart and Frederick Douglass, urged resistance through political means available, through the political means available in a democratic society, through the constitutional means that were provided in the nation's founding documents. And that was, in fact, the predominant position of black churches, for the most part, before the Civil War, and certainly after the Civil War. But into the 20th century, there was a countercurrent of support, always there, generally a minority view, but always there, of support for ideas that black separatism, black nationalism, remained the best response to an American republic that would never accept African Americans as equals. And these contrasting ideas between integrationists and separatists about the meaning of African American religious ideas and institutions, which had developed during the years of the rise of slave religion and independent black religious institutions in the North, reverberated into the future decades. Douglass and Garnett, for example, argued in terms which set the stage for much debate to come among black religious intellectuals. But all these debates, all this rhetoric coming from antebellum black ministers and activist churchmen and women, Garnett, Maria Stewart, Frederick Douglass, dozens of others in the black abolitionist movement, ultimately mattered little to the white American world. All the resolutions in the world by northern black churches and religious organizations had little effect on the great majority of white Americans until 1861, when war forced the issue. It was then that black faith became a weapon for freedom. Given opportunity and a musket, faith proved powerful. And what I'm going to conclude the talk with is by carrying forward these themes through the latter part of the 19th century, and I want to compare and contrast for you a couple of other people. William Jefferson White and Henry McNeal Turner, who in effect are carrying on some of the same debates that we have seen earlier in the talk within earlier periods of American history. And these two suggest much about the connection between religion and politics for the first generation of freed African Americans. Their lives almost perfectly encompass the full arc of African American Christianity through the 19th and into the 20th century. Both men worked furiously for African American rights and education in Georgia after the Civil War, and they fought the rise of segregation laws in the 19th century. Both also represented independent black churches during Reconstruction, which they maintained in part from the influence of their own education and skills as economically independent artisans. So let me talk first about William Jefferson White. He was the son of a white planter and a mother who was probably of mixed Native American and African American heritage. And he was light-skinned. He was so light-skinned that he could pass for white, but he chose not to. He self-identified as black. In the 1850s, as a free man of color, he worked as a carpenter and cabinet maker, thus securing the economic base that funded his post-war career as a newspaper minister and as an editor. As an educational leader, newspaper editor, and political spokesman, White labored for free African Americans in Georgia. At the first meeting of the Georgia Equal Rights and Education Association, held at Augusta, Georgia's historic black Springfield Baptist Church in 1866, White's elegant address drew the attention of someone that you may have heard of here, Oliver O. Howard, director of the Freedmen's Bureau at the time. Howard, determined to assist White in establishing schools for black children, helped him to establish Augusta Baptist Institute, which in later years became Morehouse College, the school where Martin Luther King was trained, and of course many others. In 1880, White began publishing his newspaper, The Georgia Baptist, with its masthead reading, Great Elevator, Educator, and Defender of the People. The Georgia Baptist was one of the most widely distributed black newspapers of the late 19th century. And he was then pastor of Harmony Baptist Church in Augusta, Georgia. He aggressively defended black rights amidst the growing racial turmoil of the late 19th century. After publicly denouncing a local lynching and defending its victim, a white mob chased him into his newspaper office. And his black friends had to take up sentry post and in effect spare his life. Seeking to spare his life and career in Augusta, so White basically said, I have to recant my editorial against the lynchers because they're going to kill me otherwise. So he did in fact recant the editorial, but he wrote to his son, he said, we seem to be standing upon a volcano. Later on in the early 20th century, White lent vocal support to streetcar boycotts that arose in reaction to the early segregation laws that were being passed in the 1890s and early 20th century in the South. And he wrote, quote, the colored people of Augusta are keeping off the streetcars because of the revival of Jim Crowism on them, and some of the white papers of the city are howling about it, he said. They howl if the colored people ride on the cars, and they howl if they stay off of them. What in the name of high heaven do the white people want the colored people to do? In 1906, right at the end of his life, White joined W.E.B. Du Bois, the great black intellectual of the 20th century, and other leaders to establish the Georgia Equal Rights League. But in 1906, something else happened in Georgia, the Atlanta race riot, one of the worst race riots of that era. Race riot in this era basically means whites go out and start killing black people. And in fact, they tried to kill W.B. DuBois during the 1906 race riot when he was a professor at Atlanta University. So after these 3 days of mayhem in the supposed capital, Atlanta, the supposed capital of the New South, many black leaders began to see that their hopes for racial truce were simply going to be mocked. By the time of his death in 1913, whites' religiously inspired hope of equal rights for all were a distant memory. So just the course of William Jefferson's White's life and his accomplishments and kind of the situation that he found himself in at the end of his life speak a lot about the arcs of black hopes and black disappointments and black religious thought responding to those hopes and disappointments through the course of the 19th century. And I'm going to conclude the talk by looking at one other figure that's a little bit better known than I think than William Jefferson White, and that is the figure of Henry McNeal Turner. Henry Turner's life follows a similar trajectory to White's. They lived more or less through the same exact era. So Turner was born in 1834 and raised by an extended family of women. By 1848, Turner was an avid Methodist and proponent of black self-reliance and respectability, and becomes actually a very famous preacher of the 1850s. So famous in Georgia that actually white people go to hear him because they're not accustomed to hearing a freeborn black minister who is as eloquent as he is. Turner's major life work was in fact helping to establish the African Methodist Episcopal Church in the South after the Civil War. Keep in mind, African Methodist Episcopal Church is formed in 1816. A branch of the church opens in Charleston, South Carolina. There's a presumed slave revolt, which is put down in Charleston, South Carolina in 1822. No one really knows if that was actually going to happen or not, but whites certainly think it's going to happen. And the African Methodist Episcopal Church is essentially exiled from the South during that time. The AME Church comes back to the South after the Civil War, and Turner sees his opportunity to return to the South, establish the AME Church, and make his name as a great race leader in doing so. But Turner's later life career as an advocate for immigration to Africa, going all the way back to Daniel Coker's idea, almost 100 years before now, suggests the depth of black disillusionment leading up to the era of mass migrations out of the South beginning in about 1915. So after the 1850s, as a freeborn black minister making his way and making his name well known, Turner joins the Union Army during the Civil War and serves as a chaplain. And Turner is someone who really reveres Abraham Lincoln. He reveres Abraham Lincoln in a way that Frederick Douglass did not, because Douglass had respected Lincoln but understood him to be a different kind of person, and they have a fairly, of course, complicated relationship. But Turner doesn't have any of this feeling. Turner reveres Lincoln as someone who's going to bring freedom to the slaves. After the Civil War, Turner goes about his work, and he wants to combine three different things. Civil rights organization on the one hand, church organization, AME church organization in particular, on the second hand, and racial uplift, that was the term of the era, racial uplift, by which he meant teaching slaves to be good citizens. He thought that civil rights, church organization, and racial uplift would go hand in hand. In his mind, whiteness was tantamount to godliness in America, while blackness stood for, quote, ignorance, degradation, indolence, and all that is low and vile. Turner advocated a different course. He urged black Americans to, quote, honor black, dignify it with virtues, and pay as much respect to it as nature and nature's God does. So after the Civil War, in addition to establishing these AME churches all over the place in the South, he wins election to the Georgia State Legislature. 2 years later, he's driven out of the Georgia State Legislature by, in effect, a sort of white-led coup against fellow black legislators, the argument being that those who came from servile positions were not qualified to serve in the legislature. Never mind that Turner did not come from a servile position as a freeborn American. Nonetheless, his political career was terminated, so he threw himself into church work for the next decades of his life, both in the South and eventually in South Africa. He brings the AME Church to South Africa, and the AME Church in South Africa eventually forms political branches, which in effect become the African National Congress. So there's a long connection here between the work of Henry McNeal Turner and the eventual life of Nelson Mandela. Meanwhile, he travels constantly, edits the official denominational hymnal, and wins election to be a bishop of the church, which is kind of his great ambition of that era. In the 1890s, he's watching the spread of Southern-style racism, keeping in mind he spent decades with the idea that civil rights, church organization, and racial uplift will go together. And he's beginning to give up on that idea, and he's beginning to adopt the ideas that Daniel Coker had that we talked about earlier in the talk. Turner blasts American hypocrisy in the 1890s in his paper, The Voice of Missions. So The Voice of Missions is the African Methodist Episcopal Church's denominational newspaper run by Turner in order to advocate black immigration to Africa, specifically to South Africa, which he saw as a great place where black hopes could be realized. Turner also used the paper to articulate what we would now call black theology. That is a religious thinking which identified the oppression of African Americans with the sufferings of Christ on earth. Who better than African Americans would understand the sufferings of Christ on earth is the basic question that opponents of black theology ask. He also served as a public advocate for black immigration to Africa, thinking that the movement of African Americans to the home continent would fulfill God's destiny for black people. So he travels to Liberia, Sierra Leone, and South Africa, publicizing the economic and religious opportunities available for black Americans on the home continent. Goes to South Africa in 1898 on his preaching tour. And that preaching tour was especially significant because that's when the AME Church in South Africa first takes hold and when the first inklings of what becomes the African National Congress takes hold. Even as he travels through Southern Africa, exploring the possibilities for immigration, Turner blasted the implicit and explicit racism which underlay the religious conceptions of most Americans. And he urges black Christians to adopt religious symbolism appropriate to pride in their race. Black people had every right to believe. Sorry, I didn't get Turner up there for you. There he is. Black people have every right to believe that they have been created in the image of God, he said. We have as much right, biblically and otherwise, to believe that God is a Negro as you Bukra or white people have to believe that God is a fine-looking, symmetrical, and ornamented white man, he explained in 1898. For the bulk of you believe that God is white-skinned, blue-eyed, straight-haired, projecting nose, compressed lip, and finely robed white gentleman sitting upon a throne somewhere in the heavens. So what he's really attacking is the entire world of religious symbology which had developed in the 19th century, which in effect whitened ideas of God and Jesus, and thus projected pureness and godliness onto whiteness, and by implication projects evil onto blackness. And he says, if people can create religious symbols for themselves, then we have as much right to do that as everyone else. So Turner's evolution from a freeborn South Carolinian to an African Methodist Episcopal missionary, to a Georgia Reconstruction legislature, and finally, in the last decade and a half of his life, to an embittered critic of America, an exponent of immigration to Africa, exemplifies the hopes of so many African Americans Christians, and then their bitter disappointments, the hopes placed in Reconstruction, the hopes placed in their vigorous church and denominational organizing after the Civil War, and finally, the disillusionment and search for providential answers that came with the rise of Jim Crow, which is where Henry McNeal Turner eventually ends up. So I'd like to see where my beginnings of God to conclude the talk. What was the relationship of African Americans to the Judeo-Christian tradition, or as I have used the term tonight, the Christian religion? Earlier this afternoon, I traced a kind of longer trajectory of that discussion through the course of the 20th century and down to the present day, and I was talking about these two particular figures from the present day, William Barber, minister of North Carolina, leader of the Moral Mondays movement, and the black intellectual and author, Ta Nahesi Coates. And this incorporates our current discussions of identity politics, the massacre in Charleston, the Black Lives Matter movement, and the resurgence of white nationalism. So for contemporary politics, one may look to a figure such as William Barber in North Carolina, carrying on the tradition of black civic, religious, civil rights nationalism, or of Ta Nahesi Coates, representing a long-running tradition of black skepticism, which sees little hope in traditional evangelical religions. These are just two of many of the sorts of contemporary expressions of the debate I've traced tonight for these particular figures going through the Lincoln years, going through the Civil War era, broadly speaking. And note that for some of these figures, particularly for Henry McNeal Turner, the debate was one very internal to themselves because they moved across the spectrum from hope to the disillusionment through the course of their lives. In this morning's talk, I talked about exactly the same thing with the figure of W.E.B. Du Bois for the 20th century, who was a figure in terms of his personal intellectual movement, a figure much like Henry McNeal Turner. So the Christian tradition or the Christian religion provided no simple answers. Provided no concrete solutions. It did provide plenty of ugly examples of the theological justification of racism, and it provided plenty of examples of how to inspire and exhort and move people to radically question the most basic premises of a white supremacist society. So thank you all very much for listening, and I appreciate it.
More strands of history pulled apart. Some unique linkages. With the African National Congress, I'm interested in that one. Questions?
Yes.
I was interested by your comments on Garnett. His colleagues apparently recognize the futility of violence. I'm wondering why he himself didn't, and if he did recognize there was futility in a violent response, what did he hope to accomplish by advocating that?
What he wanted was the North to form an army to fight against slavery, and as soon as they did, he joined it.
So he's not talking about black
army. I mean, he joins the Union Army, it's the first chance he gets during the Civil War, because that's actually what he's been arguing for all along. And he realizes that the Union Army is fighting for all kinds of reasons, many preservation of the Union, many which don't have to do with the end of slavery. But like Douglas, he says, I know where this thing is going to end up, so I'm going to jump in on it right now. Even if they don't know where it's going to end up, I do. It's exactly the same position. So they actually, Douglas and him, end up in the same position as far as that kind of view. And so Douglas doesn't think violence is going to end slavery until there's a Union Army, then he changes his mind quickly. And tells his son, go join, both of the sons, to go join, and they do. Or however many sons he has, I can't remember, but they all join the Union Army.
Yes.
What was the general consensus amongst the EMA as far as the use of Philemon?
The use of what?
Use of the book of Philemon in the Bible to defend their position on slavery as evil and ungodly.
So that's a great question. So they face a big problem, and so keep in mind, this is a biblically literalist culture we've been coming out of. Mm-hmm. So if it's a biblically literalist culture, it's pretty easy to make a pro-slavery argument if you're a biblical literalist. Just pick out some passages. It's essentially what they do all the time. Now you could argue about that's a different kind of slavery, and it's not about the massive transportation of people from Africa to America and so forth, but that's no one's paying attention to that kind of stuff. And so in a sense, they face the reality that within the assumptions that form 19th century American biblical exegetical practices, the pro-slavery theologians have a powerful argument. So they have to make what we would now think of as a kind of modernist argument about the spirit as opposed to the letter of the text.
Correct.
Right? And so there's a very fine book on this, in fact, by the author Molly Osatch, who basically says the creation of the anti-slavery argument was the foundation of modernism and American Protestantism, because they realized the Bible interpreted in the way that it was hopeless as an anti-slavery text. It was hopeless, it wasn't gonna work. So they have to construct other kinds of ways outside of 19th century biblical exegeses as it had been handed down to them, and they began to construct modernist ways of interpreting kind of biblical stories as, and which ones are more important and which ones contain the true lessons and which one you can just sort of toss aside as containing false lessons. So they made that kind of argument about, so the other argument they make, of course, is that, yeah, it's the ancient world, and it's about a specific time and place for a specific reason. It has nothing to do with transporting 12 million people from one continent to another to grow cotton. That's not in the Bible. That's a whole different thing. So they also make that argument as well to deal with it.
All right.
Not successfully, I would say.
When do they start switching over in the, they're trying to look at the Bible differently. I remember there was some writings, there were doing some research when that literalist reading made it really hard on abolitionists and sex, someone leaving the church altogether.
So many of them did. So even someone like Frederick Douglass, he's a pretty pious Methodist in the 1840s. And he's not by the 18, he basically junks that. And the last two decades of his life, he's kind of like a Unitarian, maybe, something like that. He's basically left all the evangelical stuff behind. That happens to a lot of abolitionists. And it happens because the pro-slavery evangelical argument is so powerful, it kind of pushes them out in a way. And the intellectual necessity of arguing against it puts them into a different way of interpreting biblical texts, which takes them out of the evangelical framework
altogether
that they had come from. That's what I think. Yeah.
Lucas.
I was listening to your presentation at 11 o'clock, and it seems like there's a trend of disillusionment with the Christian tradition throughout this that broad history you laid out earlier. How widespread was that disillusionment? Because you show these big figures, but how widespread is that on the ground? Is it making any headway?
Oh, that's a big discussion among scholars of this era. Great question. So, it depends on the time and place that you're talking about. Okay, so there's a lot of disillusionment in the 1890s and early 20th century in black communities for very good reason. It's a horrible time. 300 something lynchings a year, like one per day, like that would disillusion you fast. Okay, so there is in fact a lot of disillusionment then. And there is some recent research suggests in very localized newspapers that there's a lot, as you get to the 1910s, 20s, there's a lot of Garveyism in rural black communities, a lot more than we ever realize. And just because people have really dug into their primary source weeds, and they begin to get this out. Okay, now some people say there's a lot of that with black intellectuals as well. I don't tend to think it was that widespread. I picked some examples for you here in order to make my point that there's always this debate going on. I would not suggest to you that it's so widespread that this is always kind of like a 50-50 thing. It's not. It's kind of like a 85-15 thing. See what I mean? That's my view. A lot of other scholars disagree with that, I would say. But that's just my, because at some level, the majority of you, I think, always upholds with Douglass that we have the institutions that we have. They can get us to where we want to go if we keep pushing them to make us go. That's why Douglass doesn't reject the Constitution. It's like, if you reject the Constitution, game's over, because that's all we got to deal with as far as changing things. If you throw that overboard, then you just live in a white majority society that's going to do whatever they want. And what's that going to get you? Nothing. That's why he rejects William Lloyd Garrison's argument in a nutshell. It's just not practical. And he believes that these, like Lincoln, I think, he believes that the true spirit of the country is in the Declaration of Independence. And if you can sort of get that into the constitutional structures and the way that they work, then it's going to lead somewhere. Okay. Now keep in mind, the early 20th century, I said that this is from this morning, I said DuBois becomes disillusioned. That's like the 1940s and 50s, right? But that's because he's on the left and they arrest him because he's on the left, and then they basically force him to go into exile. So there's good reasons for him to be bitter and disillusioned, because they exile him out of the country. But in 1903, he writes Souls of Black Folk. This is as beautifully optimistic and rich kind of intellectual black literature as you could possibly possibly imagine. And he writes that in 1903 in Atlanta. He's living in Atlanta 3 years before he gets attacked during the Atlanta race riot. And he's talking about a kind of, he has a universalist vision of kind of the different ways that different racial groups bring their own qualities to America. And when you put them all together, you then have kind of the best of everything together. That was his view. He later sees that as simplistic and naive, but that was easily his view. So even in the time that I said was, there was a lot of disillusionment, there's a lot of people who were not disillusioned, like DuBois. And keep in mind, he had gotten his PhD and came back, and he thought that if we apply the methods of science to the study of American social problems, we can figure out what the problems are, and we can fix it. He really believed that, you know, for decades, I think.
I have a question myself. When you discuss certain individuals, particularly during early 19th century, they were beginning to advocate use of force, violence, to push that agenda. How many were responding, or would you like to get, how many were actually looking at it from a Christian perspective, or some type of evangelical perspective, and how many were actually using it looking back at the Haitian revolution?
Oh, good question. I would say both. Mm-hmm. I would say both, because they're looking back at the Haitian revolution, but you know, the Haitian revolution doesn't turn out all that well, because it's essentially it's nasty, and one group of free people of color ends up fighting against slaves. So it's not quite the model that they're looking for, right? It doesn't quite work as their model. So it works as a kind of generalized model of a slave uprising, but when you get into the details of it, it doesn't, first of all, it doesn't fit American society, because American society is structured differently.
Yeah.
And secondly, it's free, the people who had been free people of color come to power and then end up oppressing the former slaves in Haiti. So that's not a great model for them.
No, but it seems like that. I remember reading in the literature that there were several times where the language of the Haitian Revolution,
the language of the Haitian
Revolution, or the image of it,
yeah,
keeps being brought up from the pro-slave market.
It comes up with the American Colonization Society, because the American Colonization Society's arguments are several. Some of them are theological, like the reason God made slavery or allowed the evil of slavery is so blacks can be Christianized, go back to Africa, blah, 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 all that stuff. But the other argument is, we better get these people out of here, because we don't really want a Haitian revolution in America.
Yeah, we're going to end it.
Yeah, so there's both of those on that side of things are playing into it. So I think it's interesting from the black American context, because they have a complicated relationship with the idealized vision of what the Haitian Revolution represents, the rather gritty reality of what actually happens during it. And so what do you make, how can you make arguments for that as a result? And then these theological arguments about violence that you see Garnett and Douglas having and other people having later.
Like a lot of history. If you want a hero, don't look too close. Okay, on the back there, yes sir.
So being a Christian today, and obviously, you know, feeling that slavery and racism is an extreme sin. I mean, that's the way I feel personally. Always looking back, I always hope that there was some white church, I mean, at the time, that stood against slavery, even if there was just a few. And so my curiosity is kind of to that question, was there anybody standing against slavery as a white church at this time?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely there were. After the Compromise of 1850 and the Fugitive Slave Act, so a couple of years later, there's a famous case in Boston where some slaveholders come to arrest their runaway slave and to bring him back. And white churches, black churches and white churches, but we're talking about white churches here, so some white churches and white churchmen organize specifically to prevent the enactment of the Fugitive Slave Law. And they get into a big tussle with the local authorities there, because the local authorities have to enforce the federal law. And the white churches say, in effect, not all of them, but some of the white churches say, it may be federal law, but it's not God's law. And so we're going to oppose it. So you do have, absolutely, especially as you get closer to the Civil War, you really do have a small but very vocal minority of churches, white churches, of course black churches, but also white churches who are organizing petition drives. So there are thousands of petitions being sent to Congress, basically organized by women in churches, mostly white women in churches. They're collecting all these things. John Quincy Adams is involved with this during the last years of his life as a congressman. So yeah, absolutely, you can look to models like that for resistance to evil.
That really surprised me that they were that vocal, because I feel like they were in the minority, so I felt like, you know, they would be more oppressed.
Yeah, not only were they in the minority, but they were in a minority that often got physically attacked for having anti-slavery meetings. So if you want your heroes, white heroes from the era, you can look to that. Now, I would say that much of the recent historical scholarship literature on the abolitionist movement has shown how much of it was that came out of black churches. And so, and I think we have to put that forward as a kind of historical fact that we have to recognize. And so, putting too much stress on the white minority, I don't want to do that. But specifically relating to your question, was it there? Yeah, totally there, absolutely there. And what they endured and what they went through was rather remarkable and rather amazing to read up on. So I would recommend to you a book by the scholar Manisha Sinha, S-I-N-H-A is her last name, just put out last year, won the, whatever the award's called, for the best book in history, I can't think of the name of it, Bancroft Prize. That is a history of the abolitionist movement in general, and she goes into the history of all the stuff that I'm talking about.
Anyone else?
Where do you see
So I would put the whole, I'm no scholar of critical race theory. I know sort of generally what it is. So I would generally say a public intellectual figure like Ta Nahesi Coates, he's not a scholar, he's a public intellectual writer. So he draws on scholarship and then writes these sort of amazing essays for The Atlantic and other publications. But he's subconsciously drawing on scholarship, but they're not scholarly writings. They're personal essay, they're like James Baldwin, he's like James Baldwin in that way. So you put him, critical race theorists, and other skeptics of the utility of religious traditions. I would put all of them together in a way. So I talked about Coates this morning. So he's subconsciously an atheist that explains exactly his problem with the Christian civil rights tradition. And he says, Luther King famously says there's a moral arc to the universe and a bench towards justice, drawing on the 19th century author Theodore Parker. And Ta Nehisi Coates says, no, I don't think there's an arc. Or if there is one, at least the chaos. Okay. Critical race theorists, I think, would see the Christian tradition as part of a kind of linguistic set of words that are not useful for people seeking justice. Okay, so and other people we can put in this camp together. So I'm loosely putting together a variety of different people on the sort of skeptical side. Okay, then you have Barber, and you have all kinds of people that you've never heard of out there. My last book, Bounds of Their Habitation, I dedicated to a number of people, one of whom is a friend of mine, Andre Johnson, who's a minister in Memphis, and he got his PhD from University of Tennessee, I don't know, a few years ago, in rhetoric, but deliberately went back to his hometown in Memphis in order to start a church and he has a kind of Turner's idea of putting together, and it's a church in a working class neighborhood of Memphis, so he wants to put together a civil rights organization, uplift of working class, black working class people, and to bring the kind of traditional black religious experience. He wants to put those three things together. And I think there's a whole lot of those people out there. It's just that they never get covered in the media and they're not well known. They're just local people working. And they've never, they, they I think there's thousands of people out there like that. I really do. I just think that we don't know them because they're working